Hello, my darling. This is Willem Hop Frog Pugmire, Esquire. I've just spent the evening rereading one of my favorite Lovecraft stories, although it has been dismissed as one of his less successful stories. Indeed, some have thought it a complete failure as far as the plotting and the writing goes. I've always enjoyed it, and I have found it a very effective story, and it's the title story for the thing in the Doorstep and Other Weird Stories. The second volume of Lovecraft's fiction that was published in the Penguin Classic series. And in this delightful two-volume set from the Library of America, edited by Peter Straub. This is just these two volumes. This is such a wonderful set. It's brilliant. It's really brilliant. And the Lovecraft story that Peter selected was The Thing in the Doorstep. And I am very glad that he did so because I do really like the story. But my buddy ST Joshi doesn't he it's not one of his faves, although he did name his book The Thing on the Doorstep and Other Weird Tales, giving it. Anyway, let us see what ST has to say about the story in his notes. The Thing on the Doorstep was written on August 21 through 24, 1933, and first published in Weird Tales. The story appears to have two significant literary influences. One is H.B. Drake's The Shadowy Thing, 1928, first published in England as The Remedy, 1925. A novel about a man who displays anomalous powers of hypnosis and mind transference. An entry in HBL's commonplace book, entry number 158, records the plot germ. Quote, "Man has terrible wizard friend who gains influence over him, kills him in defense of his soul, walls in ancient cellar, but the dead wizard, who has said strange things about soul lingering in body, changes bodies with him, leaving him a conscious corpse in the cellar." Unquote. This is not exactly a description of the plot of The Shadowy Thing, but rather an imaginative extrapolation based upon it. In Drake's novel, a man, Avery Booth, does indeed exhibit powers that seem akin to hypnosis, to such a degree that he can oust the mind or personality from another person's body and occupy it. Booth does so on several occasions throughout the novel, and in the final episode, he appears to have come back from the dead. He had been killed in battle in World War I and occupied the body of friend and soldier who had himself been horribly mangled in battle. HPL has amended this plot by introducing the notion of mind exchange, whereas Drake does not clarify what happens to the ousted mind when it is taken over by the mind of Booth. HPL envisions an exact transference whereby the ousted mind occupies the body of its possessor. The The notion of mind exchange between persons of different genders may have been derived from the other presumed literary influence, Barry Payne's An Exchange of Souls, 1911, which H.P.L. had in his library. Here a scientist persuades his wife to undergo an experiment whereby their souls or personalities are exchanged by means of a machine he has built. But in the course of the experiment, the man's body dies and the machine is damaged. The rest of the novel is involved in the ultimately unsuccessful attempt by the woman, now endowed with her husband's personality but lacking much of his scientific knowledge, to repair the machine. In one sense, the story is a reprise of the case of Charles Dexter Ward, the attempt of Asenath in Derby's body to pass herself off as Edward in The Madhouse is analogous to Joseph Curran's attempts to maintain that he is Charles Dexter Ward. In noting that Asenath is in fact the soul of her own father, Ephraim, HPL may have been making a mocking allusion to the Bible, where Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, marries Joseph in Egypt, Genesis 41, verse 45. One of their offspring is Ephraim. HPL has therefore reversed the relationship of the biblical Ephraim and Asenath. HPL also chose their names to reflect the Massachusetts Puritans' fondness for using names from the Old Testament for their own offspring. Other names in the story were also of biographical significance. HPL's familiarity with Salem is reflected in the names Derby and Crown and Shield, both prominent in Salem history. The Derby House, 1761, was built by Richard Derby, 1712-1783, for his son Elias Haskett Derby and Elias's wife, Elizabeth Crowninshield. The name of the story's narrator, Daniel Upton, is an echo of Winslow Upton, 1853-1914. A professor of astronomy at Brown University and a friend of the Lovecraft family who assisted in HPL's early absorption of astronomy. HPL was so dissatisfied with the story upon its completion that he refused to submit it anywhere. At last, in the summer of 1936, when Julius Schwartz proposed to HPL to market some of his tales in England, HPL reluctantly submitted the story, along with The Haunter of the Dark, to Farnsworth Wright of Weird Tales, who accepted both of them with alacrity. Alacrity. So, HPL, he was his own worst critic. And he went to his grave thinking of himself as a failure as a writer, because he felt that he just did not succeed in conjuring in the powerful vision with which he was haunted, emotionally, psychologically, that, you know, his cosmic vision. He rarely felt that he was able to express it in as powerful a way as he deemed it deserved. And one pauses and regrets that there are many, many stories that Lovecraft began and perhaps even completed in rough draft that he was so disappointed with that he threw those stories out. You read in his letters of story ideas that he began to work on, and perhaps that he completed in rough draft, and he just threw those stories out. So the amount of work that we have lost because Lovecraft was his own worst critic. It may be of a significant amount. And that's just really sad. That's so sad. Boy. The Thing on the Doorstep takes place in Arkham. And by this time in the history of Arkham, the residents should know that Arkham is a very strange place. It's university, Miskatonic University, has a singular reputation in regards to the study of magic, and its attraction to those who those bohemian souls who practice magic. With The Thing on the Doorstep, we have one of Lovecraft's most intriguing female characters. He didn't have many female characters, but those that he invented they were fascinating. To me, I find them really fascinating. Lavinia Waitley, for me, is one of the most fascinating characters that Lovecraft created, even though his discussion of her in the Dunwich Horror is not weighty. It's almost offhand, and yet her story is fascinating. One could write a novel about the life and curious death of Lavinia Waitley. So the creation of Asnaf in Asnaf Wait, in The Thing on the Doorstep is, I mean, right at first, Lovecraft's depiction of her is filled with mystery, a very sinister mystery. Edward was 38 when he met Asnaf Waite. She was, I judge, about 23 at the time, and was taking a special course in medieval metaphysics at Miskatonic. The daughter of a friend of mine had met her before at the Hall School at Kingsport and had been inclined to shun her because of her odd reputation. She was dark, smallish, and very good-looking, except for over-protuberant eyes. But something in her expression alienated extremely sensitive people. It was, however, largely her origin and conversation which caused average folk to avoid her. She was one of the Innsmouth Waits, and dark legends have clustered for generations about crumbling, half-deserted Innsmouth and its people. There are tales of horrible bargains about the year 1850 and of a strange element, not quite human, quote-unquote, in the ancient families of the rundown fishing port. Tales such as only old-time Yankees can devise and repeat with proper awesomeness. So here we have just so many suggestions that this female creature is perhaps less than human, because she is one of the Innsmouth Waits. And she has the racial trait of the over-protuberant eyes. I have mispronounced that word, but yeah, I'm still learning English, so you must forgive me, darlings. She has the Innsmouth look. And this is an aspect of her character that commentators of the tale rarely touch on. if she is in fact the spawn of the deep ones, she is not completely human, and her hereditary fate is to become less and less human. And this is absolutely touched upon in the story, in a passage which at first I found extremely sexist, but suddenly reading it tonight, I understand it. And this is why I continue to find new things. Every time I read Lovecraft, I discover things in the fiction that I missed, that I have missed for decades. I mean, I don't know how many times I've read this story, but in this part, where is it? The worst thing was that she was holding on to him longer and longer at a time. She wanted to be a man, to be fully human. That was why she got hold of him. She had sensed the mixture of fine wrought brain and weak will in him. Someday she would crowd him out and disappear with his body, disappear to become a great musician like her magician like her father, and leave him marooned in that female shell that wasn't even quite human. Yes, he knew about the Innsmouth Bloods now. There had been traffic with things from the sea. It was horrible, and old Ephraim, he had known the secret, and when he grew old, did a hideous thing to keep alive. He wanted to live forever. Asnath would succeed. One successful demonstration had taken place already. Now, that line, she wanted to be a man, to be fully human. You know, I always thought of that as signifying Lovecraft's sexism in thinking that a female character could not be thought of as completely human because she was not male. That's not the point at all. The point is that, and he goes on to deliberately explain this in the following paragraph. Asnathwaite is a deep one. She has inhuman blood flowing in her, and she is rejecting her heritage, her deep one's heritage, her inhuman heritage. She does not want to be a hybrid. She wants to be a man, to be fully human. And thus, she transfers her soul from her hybrid body, which would eventually grow gills and become a completely inhuman. She vacated her soul from that deep one's body and occupied the soul of her husband, who was completely human, a man. It has nothing to do with sexism, and it's just, it to me, that it just adds an element to the story that I never realized before. It's quite wonderful, quite wonderful. I find the story well written. Some people say it is competently written. I think it's well written. Lovecraft was an excellent writer, despite what so many clueless, uncultured morons say online. I mean, there's so many trolls in forums on the internet. Lovecraft was a horrible writer. He wrote like a third grader. His stories, his imagination was great, but his writing sucks. And that is so untrue. Lovecraft was a brilliant writer. He was an excellent writer. He was a writer who knew what he wanted to achieve. He was trying to write fiction that was literature, that was art. Despite the genre, there is still, I think, a prejudice that to write weird fiction means that you are not a serious writer because of the genre. And Lovecraft was a very serious artist. He knew exactly what he wanted to accomplish. And although he rarely felt that he had succeeded as an artist, he succeeded more often than he did not. And we love and revere Lovecraft today for the things he got right, rather than for the things he got wrong. For the writing that is powerful, potent, and professional, rather than the stories that are badly written. We love him for the genius and the brilliance of his imagination. And much of that is in this story, the thing on the doorstep. There are several hints, things that he brings in. The story mentions Shoggoths and a forest in Maine where there is a pit of the Shoggoths, which is a phrase that has fascinated me for decades. And I want to understand what it means. What is this pit of the Shoggoths? And and then there's the interesting sexuality of the story, although I doubt that Lovecraft did this intentionally, of the idea that when Derby marries Asnath, he is actually marrying a man because her body has been taken over by the soul, the spirit of her father. So there's a little potential kinkiness in that aspect of it. Although one cannot, I doubt that they had sexual relationships, because I doubt that Ephraim, possessing Asenath's body, would feed on the sexual needs of the female body. I think he would be repulsed, perhaps. But he was a wizard, and a diabolic, sinister, and perhaps perverse wizard, so maybe he wouldn't mind sexual relationships with a man. Who knows? There's so many intriguing possibilities with that. Just that idea of a man possessing a woman's body and marrying another man. It's great. There is a very strong, it's an undertone of sexuality in Lovecraft's fiction, but it is there. The sexual mating with the inhuman, the sinister, the outsider, that is a potent theme. It is not an obvious theme in Lovecraft, but it crops up continually in his fiction. And probably it is an aspect of his racism. His racism was grotesque, but it led to a very interesting ideas of horror and disgust in his fiction. So I really like the story. I am less and less happy with the ending. I find the ending, which gave the story the title. It's like the title suggests that this is the ultimate horror of the story. But I find the ending kind of EC Comics in a way. Just the image of it doesn't thrill me in my old age. It did when I first read the story when I was young, but now the idea of the, because it is almost cliche, the idea of the corpse digging it out of its grave and appearing on and knocking on someone's door. There's just it does not satisfy me personally, but that's my own personal thing, darlings. So, all right. I have reread the story because I'm working on a novella with my friend David Barker, and it is set in Arkham, and it is tied to the idea of soul possession and transference. And so that inspired me to reread the story tonight, and I'm glad I did. I thoroughly enjoyed it. All right. Ooh, I've been talking for almost half an hour. Okay. So I'm really getting excited. Next week, I will be in Providence, Rhode Island. Next week, with I think there's going to be over 1,000 people attending this convention, the Necronomicon. Over 1,000 people. I'll be over 1,000 Lovecraft fans in Providence, Rhode Island, where Lovecraft lived. I'm like, oh honey, I'm kind of gaga. I'm getting I just think about it and I get all moist. We won't go there. Anyway, I better go because now I'm getting silly, but I can't help it because I'm thinking of a Lovecraft convention in Providence, Rhode Island. And so many important Lovecraft scholars will be there, and writers, and editors, and publishers, and filmmakers. Oh, honey, it is going to be eldritch ecstasy. Ea, Ea, Yog-Sothoth.